Welcome to the Ultimate Sports Blog Podcast. Today is Wednesday, December 5th, 2018. Today I'm going to recap NBA and NHL and college basketball games, look ahead to tonight's slate in each of those three sports, go over my NFL power rankings for the week, and do guess the line for week 14, and then guess the line for Army-Navy. I'll make a pick for Army-Navy on Saturday morning's podcast, and I'll also do my best bet of the day. But I want to open with a big free agent signing in Major League Baseball that happened yesterday around 5 o'clock Eastern time. Patrick Corbin agrees to a 6-year, $140 million deal with the Washington Nationals. Yes, the Washington Nationals. This comes to a surprise by a lot of people. But the word on the street was that his wife wanted to be in the D.C. area, and Corbin had a relationship with Nationals GM Mike Rizzo, and this tells me that the Nationals are all in on this year. They have a nice big three in that rotation of Corbin, Scherzer, and Strasburg. They're all making a ton of money, and Scherzer's obviously your ace, then Strasburg's your number two, and then Corbin, an overpaid number three. And then the four and five spots, I guess, are up for grabs. Tanner Roark, I believe, is still on the Nats roster. I thought they could have been in play for Jake Arrieta last year. I thought that was a fit for them, but they didn't go that route. I really thought this offseason that they are going to go out in the trade market and trade for one of those arms available, like Michael Fulmer, if the trade is willing to move on, or like a James Paxton, I thought was in play for them. But no, instead they spend the money on the free agent, and I wouldn't even rule out the possibility of them bringing back Bryce Harper. That said, I'd be surprised if that happened. But what a big improvement for the Nationals. There's four teams in that division where you can say that they have a case to win the division. The Nationals, you have the big three in your rotation. Oh, and I forgot they traded away Gio Gonzalez, who was a part of that rotation for a couple of years, to Milwaukee. Now he's a free agent. So Corbin, much better than Gonzalez at this point, in my opinion. So that's a great big three. And then, assuming you lose Harper, you have Victor Robles and Juan Soto in your outfield. Michael A. Taylor's like your fourth outfielder at this point. You have Ryan Zimmerman. Maybe they bring back Matt Adams. I predicted on this very podcast that they'd bring back Daniel Murphy. And you have Anthony Rendon. You also have Trey Turner. So this team is filled with a lot of versatility type of players that can play multiple positions. And you have a good twosome at catcher now with Yan Gomes, who they acquired last week, and Kurt Suzuki, who they signed on the free agent market. To me, the Nationals, the one thing they have to do is upgrade that bullpen. They acquired Kyle Barclough from the Miami Marlins and signed Trevor Rosenthal, but I don't think either of those guys are the answers for a closer. I think they're in play for one of those big-name relievers like a David Robertson or a Zach Britton, Andrew Miller, Adam Ottavino. Those are the best four relievers on the market in terms of free agency. And I thought they were a dark horse candidate to trade for Seattle's Edwin Diaz. And speaking of Diaz, the Mets get Diaz and Cano in that big trade with the Mariners. Maybe Todd Frazier comes back healthy next year and has a better year than last year. Jeff McNeil's still around. They're talking about playing him at third and putting Todd Frazier over at first base. Now the Mets are in the conversation to land JT Realmuto from the Marlins, but that's going to have the Mets give up one of their young players in either Amed Rosario, one of the two outfielders, and Brandon Nimmo and Michael Conforto. And if they do end up getting Realmuto and say they trade away Rosario, then who knows, maybe Mets ownership does something that we've never seen them do before, and that's spend six figures on a marquee free agent. And yeah, that could very well be Manny Machado. And then there's talks about them getting Bryce Harper, but I just don't see that happening. They're still the Mets. But that said, that was a great trade they made, and obviously they have Cano there. But I still think they need a catcher. They obviously have a new closer in Diaz, and maybe they go out and get a center fielder because their projected starting fielder or center fielder for opening day is Juan Lagares. The Braves, earlier in the offseason, brought in Josh Donaldson and Brian McCann, two veteran guys that will help that clubhouse going forward. Ronald Acuna is a guy that I think will make a big leap this year, or I should say next season. And then you have Freddie Freeman there still. He's in his prime. He's their best player. Johan Camargo all of a sudden becomes a utility guy for them or even a trade bait. I'm not buying Camargo as a great player. I just think that he was like a one-year wonder type of player, but I could be wrong. And that's why I like the Braves' acquisition of Donaldson so much. And Ozzie Albies, who had a bad second half of the season last year, looking to rebound a little bit. Dansby Swanson is somebody that they're banking on to live up to lofty expectations, but he really hasn't lived up to expectations since he's been in the big leagues. And they have an outfield opening, but I don't know if they're going to go bold and try to make a run at Bryce Harper, if they'll bring back veteran Nick Markakis, which I think would be a wise move. Markakis really helped that team last year. And then at catcher, obviously McCann, and then you have him platooned with Tyler Flowers, and they're talking about JT Realmuto, and I think that's weird. If that were to happen, they have to include Flowers in that deal, in my opinion, because they're not trading away Brian McCann after they just brought him back home. And obviously their pitching needs help. I thought that was the team that was going to land James Paxton. But no, maybe they go bold and trade for a starting pitcher on the market. And another thing they can use is an elite arm in the bullpen. Maybe they bring back Craig Kimbrell, who was the National League Rookie of the Year in 2010, I believe. And then they shipped him away to the Padres. Didn't work out there. Then the Padres shipped him to the Red Sox, and was a good closer for the Red Sox, fell apart in the playoffs a little bit this year, and the Red Sox might not bring him back now, and he could very well help a contender in their bullpen. And the Braves, as well as the next team we're going to talk about, the Phillies, would be a good fit for Kimbrell. Phillies missed out on Corbin. They were thought out to be the front runner to sign Corbin yesterday. I said on this podcast that I thought that Philly was the team to sign, and Mark Feinstein from MLB.com was saying that he thought the Phillies were going to sign him, that scouts told him that. I believed in Mark Feinstein, but I was wrong. And the Washington Post's Chelsea James reported that Corbin was indeed headed to D.C., so we got to give Chelsea credit for that. And what's next for the Phillies? Maybe they go out and get Dallas Keuchel. That was my prediction before the offseason. I think Keuchel would fit great in that rotation with Aaron Nola and Jake Arrieta. And then in the back end of the rotation, they have plenty of options. Vince Velasquez, Nick Pivetta among them. And they're obviously in play for all the big names, like Bryce Harper, Manny Machado. They were in play for Corbin. Now they're talking about Madison Bumgarner. That would be interesting. That would make them a relevant team in terms of playoff caliber. The moves for Segura I like. So if they were to sign Manny Machado, he'd have to play third base. But the more I think about it, I think Machado goes to New York because, and I'm talking about the Yankees, not the Mets, because they're going to have an opening at shortstop for perhaps the whole year. And then if they decide to bring back Didi Gregorius, then they move Machado to third, move Andujar across the way to first base, which I think would benefit Andujar because he was a flawed defensive third baseman last year, although he gave the Yankees plenty of offense. Machado's a great defensive third baseman, and he certainly would help the Phillies and the Yankees offensively and defensively from that position. And back to the Phillies for a second. They have to be in on one of these closers. I did not like their bullpen last year. It cost them a lot of games down the stretch. I think it's the key reason why they fell out of the race so quickly there at the end of the season. And they'll certainly be in play for one of those big four, or they'll trade for somebody. And even weirder is that the Mets' new GM, Brody Van Wagenen, came out and said that they traded for Diaz so they could block him from going to the Phillies. That's smart, but you don't go out and say that publicly. Like, what are you doing? Like, you don't say these kinds of things publicly. And who knows, maybe that'll fire up Diaz a little bit and he'll pitch pretty well, and then the Phillies could just move on and do something else. But this offseason's not over, but the NL East certainly, with all five teams in the news, and we were just talking about Realmuto with the Marlins and the chances they trade him. The Astros signed Robinson Chirinos yesterday. I believe it's a one-year deal, so that might take them out of the Realmuto sweepstakes, because Chirinos is a catcher that isn't terrible. He had a good year on the Rangers last year. So he'll probably be their starting catcher and maybe platoon a little bit with Evan Gattis, as they'll DH Gattis a little bit here and there. But Gattis' production has dropped off a little bit, so maybe the Astros know what they're doing a little bit there. And I liked Gattis a lot, and I feel like he regressed last year. And he may be a player that has seen better days. And meanwhile, Chirinos is playing the best that he's ever played. All right, let's move on from baseball. If any baseball news breaks in the middle of the podcast, we'll certainly get back into it. Go with the NBA. We started with baseball because of the Corbin news, and I wanted to go through the NL East teams and how busy they've been. Couple games last night in the NBA slate. You had five of them. The Pacers defeated the Bulls 96-90, and Jim Boylan's first game as the Bulls intern head coach. As the Pacers go to 14-10, the Bulls dropped to 5-20. Darren Collison led the Pacers in scoring. He had 23 points with 8 assists. Or I'm sorry, it's 8 boards. Miles Turner, 18 points, 11 boards. Bojan Bogdanovic, 14 points, 6 boards. Lauri Markkanen, who's come back from injury, starting to play some more minutes as he's come back, but it's going to be a while before he's back in the form. 21 points and 10 boards, so a double-double, but he shot 8 for 24. Wendell Carter Jr. had 12 points and 13 boards. Justin Holliday had 15 points and 6 boards. Zach LaVine, 13. Jabari Parker, 12 with 8 boards off the bench. Campaign off the bench, 10 points. The Magic defeat the Heat 105-90. An impressive win for Orlando. They're 12-12. Miami's 9-14. Aaron Gordon had 20 with 13 boards and 5 assists. Nikola Vucevic, 19 points, 10 boards. DJ Augustine had 11. Evan Fournier had 13. Jonathan Isaac had 12 points and 6 boards off the bench. And also off the bench, Terrence Ross had 19. Meanwhile, for Miami, Hassan Whiteside, 12 points, 9 boards. James Johnson, 11 points. Kelly Olynyk off the bench had 13. Justice Winslow off the bench had 14. Dwayne Wade off the bench had 11. The Mavericks defeat the Trailblazers 111-102. The Mavs are 12-10. Portland 13-11. Luka Doncic, 21 points and 9 boards. He had a big 3-pointer to put the game away for the Mavs. It was really, really impressive. And he's certainly the favorite for Rookie of the Year right now. Harrison Barnes had 11. DeAndre Jordan and Dennis Smith Jr. each had 12. Wesley Matthews had 17. Damian Lillard had 33 points, 8 boards, and 8 assists. He's off to a great start this season. CJ McCollum had 18. Alifrika Minu had 12. Evan Turner had 13 off the bench. Speaking of the Blazers, they really haven't played well since their hot start. I feel like they've lost 6 of their last maybe 7 or 8 games. They might actually be on the 6-game losing streak, as far as I'm concerned. Let's look real quick. Portland has lost 3 straight. So I really do think it might be a 6-7 type of situation. Meaning 6 losses in 7 games. The Kings defeat the Suns 122-105. This score after the first quarter was 36-9. Yes, 36-9. And if it weren't for that bad first quarter by the Suns probably win that game. That said, Buddy Hield 20 points. De'Aaron Fox had 16 with 7 assists. Off the bench, Harry Giles had 13. Justin Jackson had 10. Trey Williams and Kosta Kufis each had 11. Bogdan Bogdanovic had 14. Meanwhile, for Phoenix, Trevor Ariza and Josh Jackson each had 14. DeAndre Ayton had 10 with 9 boards. Off the bench, De'Anthony Melton had 21. They got him in the Marquise Chris trade. He's had a good game. Rashawn Holmes had 10 with 10 boards. And Troy Daniels had 13 with 4 3-pointers. The Jazz defeated the Spurs 139-105. Fascinating stat. This is the third 30-point loss of the season for Greg Popovich and the Spurs as they fall to 11-13. Utah improves to 12-13. Donovan Mitchell had 20. Ricky Rubio had 12, 5 boards and 7 assists. Rudy Gobert had 18 with 10 boards. Joe Ingles had 13 with 7 assists. Derek Favors had 14. Royce O'Neal off the bench had 11. LaMarcus Aldridge and DeMar DeRozan each had 16. Jakob Poeltl off the bench had 20. Derek White off the bench had 10, as well as Chimezie Metu. And Kyle Korver off the bench for Utah, forgot to mention this, had 15, including 3 3-pointers. He's been a good pickup for them so far, and they made that trade certainly at the right time because he's helped out. And tonight's slate, at 7 o'clock, you're the Warriors at the Cavaliers. I don't think that's a trap game for the Warriors. Nuggets Magic, is that a trap game for Denver? I think there's a great chance that's a trap game for Denver because they are coming off that big win in Toronto from Monday night, feeling real good about themselves. And then the Orlando Magic, who are 12-12 and currently sitting in the 7th seed in the Eastern Conference, feeling pretty good about themselves. No pressure. 7:30 Wizard Talks. That could be a trap game for Washington. They came off the big come-from-behind style win at MSG against the Knicks. We'll see. I like how the Wizards have been playing lately. Also at 7:30, you have the Thunder and the Nets. That's a possible trap game for Oklahoma City. 8 o'clock, ESPN, 76ers, Raptors. This is a great game. Mike Breen is on the call with Doris Burke. I think these are two of the best teams, if not the two best teams in the Eastern Conference right now. Jimmy Butler's made a great impact on the 76ers, and he's certainly made that team better, even though Joel Embiid's their best player. Toronto has just been phenomenal. They're the best team in the league right now. Kawhi Leonard's back to the Kawhi Leonard of old. Pascal Siakam's made the leap, like everybody said. Serge Ibaka's given them a fantastic bounce-back year, in which a lot of people wrote him off in the summertime. Oh, bad contract. What a terrible contract. Same thing with Kyle Lowry. Everyone's saying, oh, what a bad contract. Both of those guys have been great this year. And then certainly Fred VanVleet's been pretty good. That team's just rolling. I'm not betting against the Raptors. And I like them to come out with the purpose and win this game. I won't be surprised if they win this game by double digits. And you know what? I just said trap game for Denver and for Brooklyn, or I'm sorry, Oklahoma City and Washington, Golden State. Let's face it, the Raptors, that was a trap game on Monday. They were looking ahead to this game against their division rival. And the Nuggets took advantage. Although the Nuggets are a pretty good team, they're sitting pretty at 16-7, but I just think that the Raptors looked past them because they knew Philly and Jimmy Butler and Joel Embiid were coming to town tonight. So they're going to be fired up. They're pissed off after that Denver loss. I expect a lot of grit and grind and the Toronto crowd going crazy. And I expect the Raptors to win this game, if not comfortably. You have the Clippers at the Grizzlies. That's a fun game. These two teams have been, I think, the biggest two surprises in the league so far. The Pistons at the Bucks. I expect the Bucks to come out with a good performance there. The Hornets at the Timberwolves is intriguing. You have the Hornets who have been mediocre. The Timberwolves have been better since they traded Jimmy Butler, and I think that's very strange. And Minnesota is a 4.5-point favorite. My favorite underdog tonight to win outright is actually Charlotte, because I don't think Minnesota's that good, especially without Butler there. And Karl-Anthony Towns is playing pretty well, and I think Sarge and Covington have played well for them as well. Wiggins has actually been pretty solid for the T-Wolves as well. And I think the biggest surprise, other than Memphis and the Clippers in the West, has been Dallas. They're at the Pelicans. Pelicans, I think, can need this game. And they would get back to 500 here if they were to get the win. And last but not least, 10:30 ESPN, you have the Spurs at the Lakers. That is Mark Jones and Mark Jackson on the call there. Spurs are on the second of a back-to-back, and the Lakers are starting to round in the form a little bit. So give me LeBron at home to give the Spurs another double-digit loss. I don't think they'll lose by 30, but I think it's going to be somewhere like a 115-100 type of game. And the game will be put away in the last minute or so. NHL, some notable results from yesterday. It was a big slate. The Panthers defeated the Bruins 5-0, an impressive win for the Florida Panthers. They're 11-10-5, Boston 14-9-4. Number one star of the game with 33 saves on 33 shots, Roberto Luongo. The number two star of the game didn't have a point but just played well, Bogdan Kisilevich. And the number three star of the game with a goal and two assists, Jonathan Huberto. The Jets defeated the Islanders 3-1. Winnipeg 17-8-2. Islanders 13-10-3. The number one star of the game with the goal, Adam Lowry. The number two star of the game with a goal, Jacob Trouba. Number three star of the game with a goal, Anders Lee. The Penguins defeated the Avalanche 6-3. The Penguins improved to 11-10-5. Colorado drops to 16-7-5. The number one star of the game with a hat trick, Patrick Hornquist. The number two star of the game with a goal and assist, Evgeny Malkin. The number three star of the game with an assist, Ali Mata. The Flames defeated the Blue Jackets 9-6. Yes, that's a real score. Calgary improves to 17-9-2. Columbus drops to 15-10-2. The weird thing, a buddy of mine on Twitter pointed out that I mentioned before how the Suns only had 9 points in the first quarter. He goes, oh, the number of points the Suns scored in the first quarter is the same number of goals the Calgary Flames scored in a game tonight. Well, he was right about that. As the number one star of the game with 2 goals and 2 assists, Johnny Gaudreau. The number two star of the game with a hat trick, Cam Atkinson. Number three star of the game with 2 goals and 2 assists, Sean Monahan. In what was, I thought, the game of the night, the Maple Leafs defeated the Sabres 4-3 in overtime on national television. Great game. Toronto's 20-8. Buffalo's 17-8-4. The number one star of the game with 2 goals and an assist, the overtime winner, Austin Matthews. The number two star of the game with 2 goals, Jack Eichel. And the number three star of the game with 2 assists, Rasmus Ristolainen. The Canadiens defeated the Senators 5-2. The Habs improve to 13-10-5. Ottawa drops to 12-13-3. The number one star of the game with 2 goals and an assist, Max Domi. Number two star of the game with a goal and 2 assists, Jonathan Drouin. Number three star of the game with a goal, Brendan Gallagher. The Lightning defeated the Red Wings 6-5 in a shootout. Tampa Bay improves to 21-7-1. Detroit drops a 12-12-2. Number one star of the game with a hat trick, Franz Nielsen. Number two star of the game with two goals and an assist, Matthew Joseph. And the number three star of the game with two goals, Gustav Nyquist. The Wild defeated the Canucks 3-2. The Wild improved to 15-10-2. Vancouver drops to 11-16-3. Number one star of the game with the goal, Jason Zucker. Number two star of the game with the goal, Josh Levo. And the number three star of the game with the goal, Zach Parise. The Golden Knights defeated the Capitals 5-3. Good win for the Vegas Golden Knights, who have seemed to turn their season around. They're 15-13-1. Washington drops to 15-9-3. Number one star of the game with two goals and an assist, Nate Schmidt. The number two star of the game with a goal, Pierre-Edouard Bellemare. And the number three star of the game with a goal and an assist, Cody Eakin. And last but not least, the Coyotes defeat the Kings 2-1. Coyotes improve to 13-11-2. LA drops to 10-17-1. The number one star of the game with 25 saves on 26 shots, Adin Hill. The number two star of the game with assist, Oliver Ekman-Larsson. Number three star of the game, didn't have a point but just had a good game, Drew Doughty. Tonight's slate is a lot smaller, only three games on the slate on NBCSN, 8 o'clock, Oilers-Blues, two disappointing teams. I think Keith Hitchcock's team will win this game, and oh, storyline, Keith Hitchcock back in St. Louis. Didn't even think about that. So I like Keith Hitchcock to get a little revenge on one of his former stopping grounds. 10:30 NBCSN Blackhawks Ducks. Give me the Ducks at home, and they've been playing good hockey of late against the Blackhawks team that has struggled mightily since Joel Quenneville was let go. And then 10:30, you have the Hurricanes and the Sharks as well. That's just not on TV. College basketball. Some interesting results from yesterday. Seton Hall defeats New Hampshire 77-57. Seton Hall 5-3. New Hampshire 2-7. Indiana defeats Penn State 64-62. Indiana 7-2. Penn State 4-4. Providence defeats Boston College 100-95 in overtime. Providence goes to 7-2. BC drops to 6-2. BC let that one slip from their hands. Clemson survives against St. Peter's 65-60. Clemson 6-2. St. Peter's 2-6. Syracuse defeats Northeastern 72-49. Syracuse 6-2, Northeastern 4-5. Oklahoma defeats Notre Dame 85-80. Oklahoma 7-1, Notre Dame 6-2. Penn defeats Miami 89-75. Penn 7-2, Miami 5-4. James Madison defeats Radford 73-66. James Madison 7-4, Radford 6-2. Davidson defeats Winthrop 99-81. Davidson 8-1, Winthrop 4-4. Dayton defeats Detroit Mercy 98-59. Dayton 5-3, Detroit 3-6. Number 25, Furman defeats Elon 98-77. Furman 9-0, Elon 3-6. Maine defeats Fordham 75-68 in double overtime. Maine, first win of the year, they're 1-8 now. Fordham drops to 6-2. Bucknell defeats LaSalle 92-79. Bucknell 4-3, LaSalle 0-9. Holy Cross defeats UMass 82-78. Holy Cross 6-3, UMass 5-4. Boston University defeats UMass Lowell 79-60. BU 6-4, Lowell 5-6. Jacksonville defeats Presbyterian 94-88. Jacksonville 5-5, Presbyterian 4-5. NJIT defeats Army 77-72. NJIT 8-2, Army 4-6. American defeats St. Francis, Pennsylvania 95-82. American 5-2, St. Francis, Pennsylvania 3-5. Appalachian State defeats Howard 100-86. Appalachian State 3-5. Howard 5-3. Central Michigan defeats Youngstown State 100-94 in triple overtime. Central Michigan 7-2. Youngstown State 3-7. Cincinnati defeats Northern Kentucky 78-65. Cincinnati 8-1. Northern Kentucky 8-2. Bradley defeats Little Rock 68-62. Bradley is 7-3, Little Rock 4-5. Louisiana Tech defeats Prairie View A&M 82-68. Louisiana Tech 6-3, Prairie View 1-8. Georgia State defeats Alabama 83-80. Georgia State 6-3, Alabama 5-3. Missouri defeats UT Arlington 65-45. Missouri 5-3, UT Arlington 6-3-6. Mississippi State defeats McNeese 90-77. The number 22 ranked team in the country goes to 7-1. McNeese drops to 2-6. Number 8 Auburn defeats UNC Asheville 67-41. Auburn 7-1, Asheville 1-7. Number 2 Kansas defeats Wofford 72-47. Kansas 7-0, Wofford 6-3. Houston defeats Lamar 79-56. Houston 7-0, Lamar 4-5. Belmont defeats Lipscomb 76-74. Belmont 7-1, Lipscomb 6-2. UAB defeats North Alabama 73-67. UAB 6-2, North Alabama 2-7. Arkansas State defeats Evansville 87-77. Arkansas State 3-5, Evansville 4-4. Abilene Christian defeats Campbell 83-68. Abilene Christian 8-1. That's a big surprise early this season. And Campbell's 4-4. High Point defeats Valparaiso 55-53. This is what cost me my best bet yesterday. High Point 4-5, Valparaiso 5-4. Southeast Missouri State defeats Mississippi Valley State 77-57. Southeast Missouri 5-4, Mississippi Valley 2-8. Incarnate Word defeats Trinity, Texas 82-57. Incarnate Word is now 5-5. Eastern Illinois defeats Footbahn 90-37. Eastern Illinois is now 4-5. Marquette defeats UTEP 76-69. Marquette is 7-2. UTEP is 3-5. Grambling defeats San Antonio 81-57. Grambling is now 4-4. Number 5 Michigan defeats Northwestern 62-60. They avoided their first loss in the trap. They're 9-0. Northwestern 6-3. This game played exactly how I thought. I said that Michigan would win, but Northwestern would cover, and I was correct. Memphis defeats South Dakota State 88-80. Memphis is 4-4. South Dakota State is 7-3. New Mexico State defeats New Mexico 100-65. New Mexico State 7-1. New Mexico 4-2. Colorado defeats South Dakota 82-58. Colorado 6-1. South Dakota 4-4. Florida defeats West Virginia 66-56 in the second game of the Jimmy V Classic. The first one was obviously Oklahoma-Notre Dame. And I had Oklahoma. I picked West Virginia here, but I was wrong. Florida gets the win. They're 5-3. West Virginia drops to 5-3. St. Mary's defeats Bethune-Cookman 93-61. St. Mary's 5-4. Bethune-Cookman 4-5. CSU Bakersfield defeats UC Merced 67-53 as Bakersfield improves to 4-4. Tonight's slate, you have at 6 o'clock, Lafayette at UConn, 6:30, Mount St. Mary's St. John's, Ohio Xavier. 7 o'clock on the Big Ten Network, you have number 19, Ohio State at Illinois. Trap game for the Buckeyes? I'm going to say no. I think the Buckeyes go to 8-1. Harford at number 3, Duke. VMI at number 15, Virginia Tech. Western Carolina, NC State. Central Arkansas, Louisville. Brown, Butler. Monmouth, Hofstra. Navy, Delaware. Little Maryland and Drexel. Akron, Purdue, Fort Wayne. Marshall, Duquesne. Coppin State, Richmond. St. Joseph's, Princeton. Siena, St. Bonaventure. Kennepiac, Dartmouth. Towson, George Washington. William & Mary, Old Dominion. Robert Morris, Canisius. Stony Brook, Manhattan. Binghamton, Morgan State, Western Illinois, Stetson, Mercer, FAU, Detroit, Mercy, Toledo, Colgate, Columbia, Lehigh, Yale, the Citadel host, Johnson & Wales, North Carolina, North Texas at Indiana State, Illinois State at Illinois, Chicago, Miami of Ohio at Wright State, Lemoyne at number 17, Buffalo, 7:30, Middle Tennessee at Vanderbilt, Arkansas Pine Bluff at number 13, Texas Tech, Hampton at Coastal Carolina, South Carolina Upstate at Eastern Kentucky, Bowling Green at Cleveland State, 8 o'clock ESPNU, VCU at Texas. So Shaka Smart faces his old team. Oklahoma State at Tulsa on CBS Sports Network. UT Martin at Tulane. St. Louis at Southern Illinois. That's a secretly good game. North Dakota at Texas Rio Grande Valley. Florida Gulf Coast at Oral Roberts. UC Davis at Northern Illinois. Texas State at A&M Corpus Christi. South Alabama at New Orleans. Loyola, Louisiana at Louisiana. Western Kentucky at Missouri State. Temple at number 21, Villanova, 8:30, Fox Sports 1. This is an intriguing game. Temple has one loss on the season, and they've been one of the better teams in the AAC to start the year. If they get this upset win, I think it punches its at-large ticket, barring a bad AAC play. And I'm talking about Temple. But that said, I think Villanova will win this game. Although, I expect Temple to hang around. Number 24, Nebraska at Minnesota, 9 o'clock on the Big Ten Network. Trap game for Nebraska, the newly ranked Nebraska. I'm going to say yes, and I think Minnesota gets the win outright, as Nebraska is a 3.5-point favorite. But give me Minnesota in the points, and for Minnesota to win this game, straight up, as in the words of Gary Parrish from CBS Sports and the Ion College Basketball Podcast. UNC Wilmington at number 14, North Carolina, 9 o'clock ESPN2. South Carolina at Wyoming. Utah State, BYU. Ball State, Loyola, Chicago. Idaho State, Washington State. Denver Air Force, Arkansas, Colorado State. 10 o'clock. Oh, Arkansas, Colorado State was 10 o'clock. Also at 10 o'clock, TCU, SMU. That's an intriguing game if SMU are able to pick off TCU, which I think they will. I think SMU is going to win this game outright. I think that gets them a little closer to a potential at-large bid. Texas, Perm Basin at Pacific, UC Irvine, Cal Baptist, Weber State, Fresno State, Southern Utah, Long Beach State, Loyola Marymount, CSU Fullerton, San Diego State, Portland State. Number one, Gonzaga hosts Washington at 11 o'clock on ESPN2, I think Gonzaga will win that game. They're just the better team, and they're number one, obviously. And last but not least, San Francisco, California. And I mentioned SMU and Temple. I think those are big nights for them. If Temple's able to hang around, I think the committee will notice. And if SMU wins outright, I think that gives them a golden opportunity to put themselves in an at-large conversation. Because the reason why I'm discussing this is because I'm seeing a lot of disappointing teams that are Power 5 schools, like West Virginia, who lost last night to Florida, and they were unimpressive in that game at all. Turned the ball over left and right. Although they made a couple spirited efforts at a comeback, but they fell short, and they're 5-3. And Florida, despite the win yesterday, hasn't been all that impressive. And there's other teams that have disappointed so far in the Power 5, like even Villanova, but I think Villanova will be in the tournament regardless. I think West Virginia needs a big conference turnaround and conference play to get themselves back into the conversation. The same for Florida, despite the win against West Virginia yesterday. Alabama's another team that's been disappointing, but that was kind of expected after losing Colin Sexton. So they were supposed to take a step back. And Texas just lost a bye game, but they have the upset win over North Carolina on their resume to prove themselves a little bit. So, big opportunities for Temple and SMU tonight. Just throwing it out there. Now I'm going to do my NFL power rankings. Going to go from 32-1 as I do each and every time I do this. Number 32 is the San Francisco 49ers. My take: Nick Mullins is who he thought he was, the third-string quarterback. He had one good game against the Raiders. He was okay against the Giants, turned the ball over a few times, helped the Giants win that game. And then he looked like a pumpkin against the Bucks, although he put up some numbers against the Seahawks, but let's face it, garbage time. Number 31, the Arizona Cardinals. Josh Rosen hasn't been impressive. Yeah, it's early, and it's his rookie year. It certainly hurts him that Christian Kirk's hurt now. Larry Fitzgerald's at the back end of his career, so they just need some talent around him. That offensive line isn't great either. 30 is the Oakland Raiders. Hey, I give them credit. They're putting up some points at home and being competitive in home games. They were competitive a little bit against the Colts. They're competitive against the Chargers at home. They're competitive against the Chiefs at home. And I expect them to be competitive against the Steelers this week. The Steelers might win by double digits, but the Raiders are probably going to hang around for 3.5 quarters, like they did against Kansas City. Although Kansas City only won that game by 7. Number 29 is the New York Jets. What's the deal with Sam Darnold? Is he hurt? Or they're faking an injury, and he's really not ready? I'm concerned about Sam Darnold. Number 28 is the Buffalo Bills. Josh Allen has risen his stock a little bit. He's shown some flashes in that Jacksonville game and in the Miami game. I think he's going to get better. I like his running game aspect too. But the Bills hurt him a little bit by getting rid of Andre Holmes and Calvin Benjamin. Number 27 is the Washington Redskins. Mark Sanchez is their new starting quarterback. That's all you need to know, and that's the sole reason why they're in the bottom six. Number 26 is the New York Giants. Is Eli Manning playing his way into the 2019 plans? He's actually been decent and better than he was before their bye week. And since the bye week, he's been a little better. He led them to the come-from-behind win against the 49ers. He was solid in the Bucs game. He was solid for a half against Philly, and then they fell apart. And then he was better than the stats said against the Bears and made some good decisions in that game, such as finding a wide-open Odell Beckham Jr. on fourth and goal in that game. So he might be playing his way into next season's plans, which is going to anger a lot of people in the New York media and some Giants fans. And he'll probably retire next season rather than after this season. Number 25 is the Cincinnati Bengals. They've pretty much have quit. Marvin Lewis just needs to get fired. They just need a new voice, and I think that'll help them so much. And I'm going to get to another team that needs a new voice in a couple seconds here. 24 is the Jacksonville Jaguars. Is Blake Bortles done in Jacksonville for good? Are they going to go after a quarterback and with their first-round pick this year? Number 23 is the Atlanta Falcons. Is Dan Quinn in trouble? Yeah, he's 2 years removed from a Super Bowl, but that collapse is on his watch, and they haven't really been the same since that Super Bowl collapse. They're offense red zone has been terrible the last 2 years. And although Matt Ryan's put up the stats, but he really hasn't been that great. Number 22 is the Green Bay Packers. They need to go big game hunting for their new head coach. You're the Green Bay Packers, and you have the most talented quarterback in football on your team. You have to make a splash with this hire. Josh McDaniels, I'm not a big fan of Josh McDaniels. I'm in the minority, but he was a bad coach in Denver. He failed in Denver. He is probably a coordinator at best, and I think the Giants are learning that with Pat Shurmur a little bit. I think the media and the Giants fans are giving Shurmur too much credit for this little spurt that they've had. But this spurt is because of two reasons. Saquon Barkley and Odell Beckham Jr. That's it. But back to the Packers. They need to go big game hunting for a coach and not hire one of these former head coaches that were good coordinators. Like no Jim Schwartz, no Josh McDaniels. Go big game hunting. Go for Jim Harbaugh. If John Harbaugh's let go for the Ravens, go after him. Like, that's big game hunting. You have Aaron Rodgers on your team. I think Aaron Rodgers' career is going to be considered one of the more disappointing careers if he doesn't achieve one more Super Bowl. Disappointing, I mean, from a standpoint of how did he not win more than one championship and say, like, Eli Manning has two. Like, Aaron Rodgers is the most talented quarterback in this league, and he just doesn't have the talent around him. This McCarthy divorce was well overdue. They did it at a surprising timing, but them and the Browns are going to be fighting for new coaches. And a lot of people out there think that the Browns' job is more intriguing than the Packers' job because Baker Mayfield might be a better long-term guy than Rodgers, and there's some thought out that maybe Rodgers is in decline and yada yada. I'm not buying the Rodgers is in decline motion. Go get him talent. And from a Browns perspective, there's more than just Baker Mayfield. Baker Mayfield is probably going to be a franchise quarterback, as what he's shown so far this season, although he did not play well last week. Nick Chubb's a good player. Myles Garrett's a great defensive player. And they have talent on that team that the Packers, they don't have talent other than Aaron Rodgers. They just don't. The receivers are okay, but Aaron Rodgers makes them great. All right, enough of this Packers rant. And speaking of the Browns, they're actually number 21, so that's a good segue. Mike McCarthy or Bruce Arians? I think one of these two gentlemen will be the next head coach of the Cleveland Browns. And I already talked about them a little bit when I was talking about the Packers. Number 20 is the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. With their good play of late, is Dirk Cutter saving his job? As well as Jameis Winston, perhaps. Number 19 is the Miami Dolphins. We have to give them credit. They're 6-6 and still in the playoff hunt. They're clearly the worst team that's not under 500. But that's credit to Adam Gase. I think he's done a nice job this year. And Ryan Tannehill's back, but he hasn't looked bad. He was good in the Indy game, but Indy came back and won that game. Give Indy credit. And he was pretty decent in that Bills game as well. Number 18 is the Detroit Lions. Kerryon Johnson and Marvin Jones have been out the last few weeks, but I don't think Matthew Stafford has been worth his big contract at all. He single-handedly cost them the game on Thanksgiving against the Bears. And he hasn't won anything. Not even the best team in the division. They're the worst team in that division, as far as I'm concerned. Although you could argue Green Bay is. But the sole reason why they're the worst team in that division is because Aaron Rodgers is on the Packers. The Packers have a worse roster than the Lions, but the Lions just really haven't put it together. And I think Stafford, I think that's just the common denominator. And I'm not a big fan of Matt Patricia either. Number 17 is the Tennessee Titans. That was a huge win against the Jets last week. Come from Einstein to put themselves back in the playoff mix. They have to win against Jacksonville or else they're a fraud. Number 16, the Indianapolis Colts. That was just a terrible loss to the Jaguars. They're this low because they lost to the Jaguars. They lost to Cody Kessler, USC castoff. What the heck, Colts? They're clearly looking ahead to the Texans, and the Texans have more talent than they do. That's just the bottom line. I like this Colts resurgence. Andrew Luck has been great this year, other than last week. But that was just such a bad loss. It gave me a bad taste in my mouth. If they're able to rebound and beat Houston and Houston, then I'll give them credit again. Number 15 is the Philadelphia Eagles. Two straight wins to put them back in the NFC playoff picture. I think that sixth wildcard spot is wide open. I think the second place NFC East team's in play for that spot because Minnesota and Carolina have not played well of late. Seattle, I think, is the front runner for the 5-2. We'll get into them in a second. But there's some arguments to be made that this is a fluke and the Giants and the Redskins are just this bad. Number 14 is the Carolina Panthers. Four straight losses and they are falling apart like rain. And Ron Rivera may be a coach that's in trouble. Number 13 is the Baltimore Ravens. They're 3-0 with Lamar Jackson, but Lamar Jackson hasn't done anything so special. Like, what's special about Lamar Jackson? The fact that he can just run around and do whatever? Like, come on. They're frauds. They're going to lose to Kansas City this week. Number 12 is the Denver Broncos. This is the team I like a lot, and I think they have a real chance to be the sixth wildcard team in the AFC. Right now, the Ravens hold that spot, but like I said, I think the Ravens are frauds, and I think Denver is the easier schedule down the stretch, and I think they take control of that spot. Philip Lindsay, to me, is a dark horse candidate to steal Saquon Barkley's Rookie of the Year. But the case against Barkley is that the Giants have underachieved, but they didn't underachieve because of him. They underachieved because they have a bad head coach and a quarterback in decline and a defense that isn't that great either. And has a bunch of overrated guys on that end. But Lindsay's had a great rookie season. And will be at least a finalist for this award, but he's no Saquon Barkley, not even close. Number 11, I have the Minnesota Vikings. My issue with them is that they haven't beat anybody good this season. And Kirk Cousins is putting up stats, but not wins. That's my problem. Yes, Kirk Cousins is an upgrade over Case Keenum. Case Keenum's been a big part of Denver's resurgence, but I think he just has talent around him and a great defense like he did in Minnesota, and that's why he's succeeding. But Cousins has been Jekyll and Hyde this year, and I think the Vikings will ultimately end up in the playoffs because I think Philly loses to Dallas this week, and or in all likelihood will lose to Dallas this week, and yeah, they'll probably lose to Seattle. But if they beat Seattle, then that puts the Vikings in a great position to make the playoffs. But I do think this is ultimately your sixth seed in the NFC. And I really think that this is a good team. Great pass rush. Good running backs. Great receivers in Diggs and Thielen. A good tight end in Rudolph. A good, at worst, quarterback in Cousins. Not great. But he can be great on occasion. He was great against the Packers. But my issue, like I said with them, is they haven't beaten anybody good this year. And that's why part of me isn't sold that they're a Super Bowl contender. And I feel like more of a disappointment than a Super Bowl contender this year. Number 10 is the Dallas Cowboys. I have to give credit where credit's due. This is the best team in the NFC East this year, right now. They had the amazing win against the Saints. Yeah, no offense was needed because their defense was just that outstanding. Like I said, the NFC East is theirs to lose. If they don't win the NFC East, Jason Garrett's going to be out of a job. That's facts. Amari Cooper has really helped that offense. And Dak Prescott is a quarterback that is very polarizing. There's a lot of people that think that he is the answer and some that don't think he is. And there's some argument on the Get Up show today how they should have played Tony Romo instead of him down the stretch in that year where they won the NFC East in Ezekiel Elliott and Prescott's rookie seasons. And they're saying that they would have won that playoff game against the Packers. I disagree with that notion. Because you don't know if they would have won that game against the Packers with Romo or with Prescott. Ultimately, Romo is just hurt all the time. And shout out to Leighton Vander Esch of the Cowboys, who I think is one of the co-front runners for Defensive Rookie of the Year. I'll get into the other one in a minute. Number 9 is the Chicago Bears. I'm starting to think that this team's a fraud. And that is your argument for the Vikings stealing this division. I think there's a chance that the Bears lose to the Rams on Sunday night, even though they're home. But that Giants loss was bad. I get it. It was Chase Daniels and Mitch Trubisky. But their defense wasn't good in that game. No, it wasn't. Yes, Saquon Barkley is the best running back in football, and Odell Beckham Jr. is one of the best three, if not the best wide receiver in football. But Eli Manning's their quarterback. He's not good anymore. As I keep saying on this podcast over and over and over. Listen, their defense was very good in the first half, but that defense fell apart in the second half. And I had to give Daniel and that offense credit for them coming back. But they lost. They lost to the then 3-8 Giants with a bad coach and a washed-up quarterback. Like, I'm starting to think that they're a fraud. And the other thing is, Matthew Stafford single-handedly gave the Bears the game on Thanksgiving. They should have lost that game. The Chicago Bears should be 7-5, not 8-4. That's my point. They're a fraud. I'm not picking them to win the Super Bowl under any circumstances, no matter who's their quarterback. And I like Trubisky, but I don't think he's even the best quarterback from their draft class. If I had to rank that quarterback draft class, it's Mahomes, Watson, then Trubisky. Not that Trubisky stinks, but there's two guys I consider better than him right now. Number 8, the Pittsburgh Steelers. That was a bad loss on Sunday night, and it came at a costly price as they lost James Conner, at least for this week, against the Raiders. And I'm not saying that they would have won the game if James Conner didn't get hurt. A lot of their fans certainly think that, but I'm not sure. It's similar to the Tony Romo thing, as I mentioned a few minutes ago with the Cowboys from a few years ago. And the same thing could be said about Trubisky in the Giants game. But like I said, I don't think Trubisky's that great. And yes, I think they're doing the right thing by sitting James Conner this week because the Oakland Raiders are trying to get that number one pick to draft Nick Bosa. So I guess it's the right decision to sit him. I still think they'll probably win that game by double digits. But that was just not a good loss. And I actually thought it was wise of them to go off sides because, like Philip Rivers said in that interview to Michelle Tafoya on Sunday night, that he thinks they're trying to do that to, it was their version of icing the kicker because they're out of timeouts. Very wise, but it ultimately came back to haunt the Steelers as they end up losing the game on the game-winning field goal on Sunday night. And the Ravens are lurking only a half game back of them now. A half game. Steelers are 7-4-1. Baltimore 7-5. But like I said, I think Baltimore's a fraud. Lamar Jackson ain't that good. And I still think the Steelers are in good position to win this division. Especially with that head-to-head win over the Ravens a few weeks ago in Baltimore. Number 7 is the Seattle Seahawks. This team is playing great football at the right time. I think Russell Wilson is a long shot. Good long shot bet to win MVP. Drew Brees had the bad game against the Cowboys, which I think hurt his case. And I think Russell Wilson's on the rise for his case. I think Mahomes is the favorite right now, but you got to put Russell Wilson at least second or third along with Brees and Mahomes. And he's single-handedly carried this team, in my opinion. I didn't think this was a good team before the year. But credit him and credit, obviously, Pete Carroll as well. Number 6 is the Houston Texans. 9 straight wins is 9 straight wins. At some point, credit has to be given. I think this is a dark horse Super Bowl team. They're starting to look like the team that I thought would be the dark horse AFC winner that I thought they'd be before the season. It just took them a while, but here they are. They're 9-3 and are in seized control of the AFC South. Clearly the best team in that division as far as I'm concerned. Number 5 is the New England Patriots. I think the AFC can be theirs for the taking. The Chiefs just lost Kareem Hunt. The Texans, I think, are pretty good with 9 in the row, as I'm saying, but their case against them is that are they peaking too early? And also, the Pats haven't peaked yet. That's the case for New England. Number 4 is the Los Angeles Chargers. Amazing win last week. This could be a tricky spot against the Bengals at home, although the Bengals don't have Andy Dalton. But goodness, wouldn't it be so Chargers to lose to Jeff Driscoll and the Bengals because it was a letdown slash trap game with the Chiefs looming next week? Number 3 is the Kansas City Chiefs. Speaking of them, I think the Kareem Hunt suspension can hurt them. Charcandrick West is back. He re-signed with them, so he'll be one of their running backs going forward. Number 2 is the Los Angeles Rams. They have the inside track on that one seed, in my opinion. Aqib Talib is back. He'll help them. And number 1, the New Orleans Saints. Yeah, they just lost to the Cowboys. But I think last week was an aberration. But I think with that bad performance, Brees could have cost himself the MVP. He had also another sort of mediocre performance in Minnesota, although the Saints won that game. The Saints won that game because Kirk Cousins turned the ball over twice. That's why New Orleans won that game. Minnesota should have won that game, but Kirk Cousins gave that game away. And I still like the Saints team. I think them and the Rams should be co-favorites in the NFC. And they should be the two teams that are going to meet up on Championship Sunday, which will be January 20th. Guess the lines for week 15. As I do each and every week, I probably should have done this yesterday, but I forgot. There's a lot of other news going on with Urban Meyer retiring, and I wanted to talk about Corbin yesterday and the NHL expansion team. There's other things I wanted to get into yesterday, but so we're doing it today. Jaguars at the Titans. I have the Titans by 7. The Titans are laying 4. And the Titans, I think that's a low line. I wonder if Vegas is buying into the good defensive performance the Jaguars had last week. I'm going to go the other way. I think that was an aberration because the Colts are looking ahead to the Texans. That's how mad I am at the Colts. That's why I had them so low on my power rankings. Jets at the Bills. Bills by 3. Bills are laying 3.5. So the Bills get the half point. That's interesting. Panthers at the Browns. I have the Panthers by 3.5. The Panthers are only laying 1.5. The Falcons at the Packers. I have the Packers by 4.5. The Packers are laying 5.5. Ravens at the Chiefs. I have the Chiefs by 6.5. And that's what the line is. Patriots by 5 at the Dolphins, and it's Pats by 7.5. That's a little high. Saints at the Buccaneers, I have the Saints by 7.5. It's Saints by 8. Giants at the Redskins, I have Giants. I have to change this because I thought Colt McCoy was going to be their quarterback. I'm going to say Giants by 3. It's 3.5. Colts at Texans. Texans by 6. It's Texans by 4.5. I think that Vegas agrees with me that, or I should say, not agrees with me, but starting to think like me that the Colts were sort of looking ahead and that performance last week was a fluke. But I just think that they're disrespecting the Texans a little bit. The Bengals at the Chargers. I have the Chargers by 12.5. The Chargers are favored by 14. The Broncos at the 49ers. I have the Broncos by 6.5. It's 5.5. Eagles at the Cowboys. I have the Cowboys by 3.5. And that's what the line is. Steelers at the Raiders, I have Steelers by 10. It's 10.5. Lions at the Cardinals, I have Lions by 3. It's Lions by 2.5. Rams at the Bears, I have Rams by 6. It's 3. That's low. Vikings at the Seahawks, Seahawks by 3. It's Seahawks by 3. So, 3 correct guesses this week by me on Guess the Lines. And Army, Navy, I'm going to say that Army is minus 13, yes, 13 against Navy, and Army's only laying 7. So I just think that's a lot of Navy money coming in, and I just think Army's better than Navy, period, end of story. Navy's been disappointing this year, and Army has been amazing this year. Best bet of the day, sponsored by DraftKings. The Golden State Warriors over the Cleveland Cavaliers. I just don't see them losing to the Cavaliers in the finals rematch, especially without LeBron there. The Thunder over the Nets. I just think that OKC won't look past Brooklyn. The Washington Wizards, same thing. I don't see the Wizards looking past Atlanta. Although, if anybody's going to kill me on this, it's going to be them. The Pelicans over the Mavericks. I just don't like the Mavs on the second of a back-to-back. Anthony Davis is the best player in that game. Milwaukee over Detroit. I just think that Milwaukee is significantly better than Detroit. The Lakers over the Spurs. Spurs on the second of a back-to-back, and Lakers are rested. And in college, along with those 6 NBA teams on this Moneyline Parlay, you have UConn, Butler, Louisville, Richmond, Delaware, and Vanderbilt. Plus 581, only wagered 20 cents with a payout of $1.36. And that's it for the podcast today. I'll be back tomorrow recapping NBA, NHL, college hoops. I'll be doing some other things tomorrow, NBA and NHL power rankings, maybe more MLB talk. Talked about the NL East today. Maybe I'll talk about another division tomorrow for their offseason. Maybe another random move or two is made, and we'll get into that. And then, obviously, best bet for tomorrow. And I hope you guys have a great day, everyone.